Add-on Desire. Hello viewers, welcome to Adot Solutions Daily Current Affairs. I'm Lokesh Penagonda. This session is designed for aspirants preparing for banking, groups and such other competitive examinations. We cover news articles from both The Hindu and The Indian Express. Make a use of this session. Due to a combination of technical difficulties and government restrictions, we could not upload several current affairs videos of last week in our YouTube channel. Any inconvenience caused is deeply regretted. First, we have an article where the Chief Justice of India has asked the Chief Justices of various high courts to speed up the filling up of judicial vacancies. So, there was a two-day conference with the Chief Justice of India along with the Chief Justices of various high courts, and in this conference, the Chief Justice of India, Mr. N.V. Ramana, who is also the 48th Chief Justice of India, has asked Chief Justices of various courts to speed up the judicial filling so that there won't be no delay in completion or clearing of cases that are pending in various high courts. And also, he reiterated his wish for the creation of National Judicial Infrastructure Corporation. He is asking for the creation of National Judicial Infrastructure Corporation. So why is the Chief Justice of India asking the government to set up such a body? Last year, when the COVID pandemic has struck the country, many courts have to shift from physical hearings. They have to shift from physical hearings to virtual hearings. And we know that several courts in the country does not have required infrastructure. And it is a common fact that courts, especially at the lower level, that is at the district level, at the town level, and sometimes at the village level, we have the village nyayalayas, these courts does not have adequate judicial infrastructure. So, to create the necessary infrastructure and to bring uniformity in the judicial infrastructure in the country, the Chief Justice of India has been asking the government to bring in such a body. Next, we have an article where the DAC has approved for the building of 6 conventional submarines. So, we'll see first what is the DAC. DAC stands for Defence Acquisition Council. Acquisition Council. This is the highest body. This is the highest decision-taking body. Decision taking body when it comes to implementation or when it comes to bringing up of new policies and when it comes to buying or acquisition of required equipment for the armed forces. So, to bring in new policies and to buy weapons for the armed forces, this Defense Acquisition Council is the highest ever authority. You should note that this Defense Acquisition Council is chaired by, that is headed by the Defense Minister of the country, who is Mr. Rajnath Singh at present. And in the yesterday's Defense Acquisition Council, it has cleared for the, it has given its approval for the construction of 6 conventional submarines. So what do you mean by conventional? Conventional means the usage of conventional or traditional fuels, that means diesel powered or petrol or any other conventional fuel powered submarines. So whenever we use the word conventional submarines, it typically, that means it generally means diesel powered submarines, whereas we have advanced submarines which are being powered up by nuclear energy. So the conventional submarines are not nuclear powered, and now the Defense Acquisition Council is giving its nod for construction of 6 conventional submarines through the strategic partnership model. Through the strategic partnership model, this becomes a significant issue because this is for the first time ever, this is for the first time, the Defense Acquisition Council is approving the construction of something through the strategic partnership. So what do you mean by the strategic partnership when it comes to the submarines? It means that these submarines will be built in India. That is, they will be made in India, whereas for making in India, they does not have, or they might not have the necessary infrastructure, or they might not have the necessary design and development proposals or models. So they would have to partner with foreign manufacturers. So this is like a PPP model, that is public private partnership. This is similar to this model, but whereas in this model, both the Indian company and the foreign company might be private company. So this is with respect to the strategic model, which is being used for the first time for the construction of 6 conventional submarines. And you should note that these submarines are being constructed under the P-75, under the P-75I, that is under the Project 75I. This 6 conventional submarines will be manufactured in the country. And you should note that for construction of the submarines, nearly 43,000 crores have been set aside, or nearly 43,000 crores is the estimated cost of the 6 submarines. Next, we have an article which is talking about the lessons that India should learn from China. In the year 1980, the government of China has brought a policy called as one child policy. It means that any married couple can only have one child. So a married couple can only have one child, and people or couples who are having more than one child will be heavily penalized. So they might be sent to the prisons, or they might be given huge penalties to pay. And this has led to the huge reduction of fertility rates. In the country of China. So what do you mean by fertility rate? Fertility rate refers to number of children a woman will give birth to. So in the year 1980, before the launching of this one child policy, China has a fertility rate of nearly 6. That means every woman will give birth to 6 children on average. And in the year 2014, the total fertility rate in the country has been reduced to 1.6 child per average. So if you have, let's assume that if you have 10 women, these 10 women will give birth only to 16 children. That means one woman on average give birth to 1.6 children. So you can see that from giving birth to 6 children per woman, the birth rate reduced, the total fertility rate reduced to 1.6 children. And what will be the impact of this? Due to the reduction of childbirths, the population percentage of senior citizens in the country increased drastically. So the children in the country is less, whereas the senior citizens in the country are very high. And according to various estimates, the one child policy the Chinese government has followed from 1980 till 2015 has led to aversion of 400 million children birth. So nearly 400 million children could not be born due to this one child policy. And due to drastic reduction of total fertility rate, the Chinese population is undergoing a demographic impact, and it is fearing a demographic catastrophe. And for this reason, in the year 2014, the Chinese government has approved a policy which permitted married couples to have 2 children. So, from 1980 onwards till 2015, every married couple can have only one child. And from 2015 till this week, every married couple can have two children. And even though the Chinese government has relaxed the children policy or the child policy, the number of childbirths could not increase drastically. So, the Chinese government recently has brought in a new policy where it has approved couples to have three children. So from now onwards, every married couple can have an option of bearing three children. And the writer in this article is stating that India also is facing demographic impact. India is also having, will have demographic problems because it is stating that even in the country India, there are 18 states, there are 18 states which have total fertility rate less than 2. So, the total fertility rate is less than 2 in 18 states. So, the author of this article is stating that Indian government should try to bring in the total fertility rate at least to the replacement level, at least to the replacement level. And we also already know that the replacement level is 2.1. So this is what the article is talking about. Next, we have an article dealing with the Corbivax. So what is this Corbivax? In our yesterday's current affairs session, we have seen how the Union government has paid 1500 crores as an advance to buy 30 crore COVID vaccines. 30 crore COVID vaccines from a firm called as Biological E. So, the government has paid 1500 crores as an advance to buy 30 crore COVID vaccines from the Biological E, which is a vaccine making firm headquartered in Hyderabad. Now, the article is stating that the coronavirus vaccine, which the biological firm E produce, is being named as Corbivax. And in this article, it is stating how this Corbivax is different from the other COVID-19 vaccines, which have been produced by Moderna, Sputnik, Bharat Biotech, and AstraZeneca. It is stating that instead of using the entire virus, which is weakened to the patients, this Corbivax will only use certain spikes of the protein. So, instead of following a method where a weakened virus will be given to citizens as a vaccine, what this Corbivax is doing is that it will try to inject only proteins, the only spikes of proteins of this virus, spikes of proteins of this virus in to the citizens as a vaccine so that their immunity can be developed. So this is how the Corbivax is different from other COVID-19 vaccines. Next, we have an article where the country Nigeria has suspended the Twitter for 2 days after the Twitter removed the president's post. So we'll see what happened in Nigeria and we'll see why the Nigerian government has suspended the Twitter. Earlier this week, the president of Nigeria has condemned the violence that is taking place in the country and he stated that he will punish those groups that are involved in violence which is taking place in the country. And Twitter has stated that this tweet of the president of the Nigeria is against the Twitter rules and it has blocked the tweet of the president. And the president of the Nigeria has stated that as Twitter is blocking the legal content which is posted by him, he will be blocking the usage of the Twitter in his country for 2 days. So we'll see where Nigeria is. Nigeria, you can see in this image, is a West African nation. and it opens into Atlantic Ocean. It opens into Atlantic Ocean. The capital of Nigeria is Abuja. Its capital is Abuja. Next, we have an article where the OPCW has stated that there are clear-cut cases where it stated 17 times a chemical weapon is used by Syrian authorities. So we'll see what is this OPCW. OPCW stands for Organization for Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. For Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. From the name itself, we can understand that this is an organization that will try to prohibit the usage of chemical weapons. So, this is a body which was set up in the year 1993. So, in the year 1993, there was a meeting or there was a treaty called as Chemical Weapons Convention. So, there was a convention or a treaty called as Chemical Weapons Convention, and to enforce the treaty which took place in the Chemical Weapons Convention of 1993, it has created the OPCW. You should note that the headquarters of this organization is in Hague, which is in Netherlands. So, the objective of the OPCW is to prohibit the usage, prohibit the stockpile, prohibit the sale and transfer of chemical weapons. And it is stated, the organization has stated that in the last few years, 17 times Syrian government has used chemical weapons on its own people. Why would a country use chemical weapons on its own people? In the image you can see Syria, and in the image you can also see that only the violet part is under control of Mr. Assad, who is the head of the Syrian government. Whereas we have parts in the northeastern and in the north part which are being controlled by other forces. So we have the Kurdish forces, which is a separatist organization, and this separatist organization is controlling huge territories in its northeastern part. Whereas we have the country of Turkey, which occupied and which is controlling several parts in the northern part of the country Syria. So there is a civil war, and there are many forces which are occupying the Syrian country. So to help the government get back its territories, the Syrian government forces are using numerous types of weapons on its own citizens and on the rebels. And as a part of this, the Syrian government has used chemical weapons on rebels and on some citizens as well. You should also know that the capital of Syria is Damascus. Next, we have an article which is talking about Hong Kong sealing of the Tiananmen vigil site. So, what is the Tiananmen vigil site? In the year 1989, There were huge protests in the country of China, requesting the Chinese government to come down or to resign and allow for democracy. So, there are people, mainly the students in the country of China, who are requesting the government and protesting for democracy. And China, we know that, is a authoritarian regime. Authoritarian regime, and also it follows communist rule. So the Communist Party of China has used brutal force to suppress the protests which are being held at Tiananmen Square. So Tiananmen Square is an area in China where thousands of students have come together protesting for bringing up of democracy in the country, and the communist forces of China has unleashed force on these protesters, and as a result thousands of the protesters has lost their lives, and world over to mark this brutal suppression on democratic forces in the China. Numerous countries observe Tiananmen vigil, which means they're observing the death of protesters who have lost their lives in the Tiananmen Square protests. And we know that Hong Kong is an autonomous region of China, and every year on the date in which on which many many thousands of protesters died, there is a park in which many people will come together and will observe the death and will mourn the death of the loved ones. And this has been, this park has been sealed off by the Hong Kong authorities. So if you come up to a question which is talking about the Tiananmen Square protest or the Tiananmen Square massacre, you should know that this is relating to the country China. Next, we have an article where the finance minister, Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman, is asking the public sector undertakings to front load capex, that is, to front load the capital expenditure. We know that after the COVID pandemic has struck the country, numerous people has lost their lives, numerous people has lost their jobs, and the economy has shattered, and there is even negative growth in the GDP. To recover from this pandemic economically and to provide jobs to the people, the finance minister, Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman, is asking the public sector enterprises such as the ONGC, the Life Insurance Corporation, the State Bank of India, other steel industries and other industries which come under the government, to increase its capital expenditure and to concentrate more on capital expenditure. That means it is asking these industries to construct more infrastructure. Why is the finance minister asking these companies to increase their capital expenditure? Let's assume that there is a company called as ONGC, and ONGC, if it is starting a new plant somewhere, it would have to construct the new plant. So for constructing of the new plant, it might have to employ 1,000 people. So new building, new infrastructure can be created for the new ONGC plant. So you can see here, for the construction of the building and for running of this building, 1,000 people will be employed. So 1,000 people will get jobs. So 1,000 families can have a better economic growth and can have income. So this is why Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman is asking the public sector undertakings to front load capital expenditure, which is called as CAPEX. Next, we have an article where RBI, which is a central bank of the country, has stated that it will purchase G6 worth 1.2 lakh crore in the second quarter of this year. So we'll see what is this G6. G6 stands for government securities. So what are the government securities? Government securities are the loans which the government take by issuing of government securities or through bonds. So let's say the government wants to take a loan of 1,000 rupees. So what it will do is, it will issue a thousand rupees bond, which will be called as a government security bond. And let's assume that there is person A, and this person A buys this 1,000 rupees bond. So he is paying 1,000 rupees to the government, and in return he is getting a bond. Why is he buying a bond by paying 1,000 rupees to the government? He knows that if he pays 1,000 rupees, he will not only get 1,000 rupees back after some time, but he will also get some interest. So the government issues bond, people will buy this bond, and the government not only will pay the principal amount, but also it would have to pay interest amount later. So as the government revenue has reduced due to COVID-19, the government is taking 1.2 lakh loan from RBI through issuance of government securities. Next, we have an article where the Monetary Policy Committee has held rates. So, what is this Monetary Policy Committee? Monetary Policy Committee is the body that will be responsible for keeping the inflation between 2% to 6%, and to keep the inflation between these rates, it will be increasing or decreasing several rates. So what are these rates? It may be the repo rate, it may be the reverse repo rate, or it may be other rates or other instruments. So we'll see what are these repo rate and reverse repo rate. Repo rate is the interest rate the RBI will pay, RBI will charge if any commercial banks are taking loan from the RBI. So let's assume that there is the State Bank of India. State Bank of India does not have enough money to provide loans. So what it will do? It will ask the RBI to provide 1,000 crores as a loan. RBI will provide these 1,000 crores after taking some guarantees from the State Bank of India. And RBI will state that as you are taking a loan, you have to pay me some interest rate. And what will be this interest rate? This interest rate will be the repo rate. So whatever interest rate the RBI charges when it is giving loan to the commercial bank is called as repo rate. Then what do you mean by reverse repo rate? Reverse repo rate means the RBI will get some interest, will have to pay some interest if it is taking any loan from a commercial bank. In the earlier case, we have seen the State Bank of India taking loan from the RBI. And let's assume that the RBI needs some money from the State Bank of India. So the State Bank of India will pay 1,000 crores as loan, and as the State Bank of India is loaning some amount to the RBI, it will take some interest from the RBI. This interest the RBI will have to pay to the commercial banks is called as reverse repo rate. We have an article where the France economy minister, Mr. Bruno Le Maire, has stated that they are just few steps away on agreeing a global minimum tax. So what is this minimum tax they are planning to adapt? Earlier in the last month, we have Mr. Joe Biden, that is the United States president, asking several member countries of the world to set up minimum corporate tax as 21%. So what do you mean by a minimum corporate tax? We have corporates or private companies such as the Google, the Tata Industries, Reliance. So these are all private industries, and they have to pay certain amount to the government as tax. So if the United States government has a corporate tax policy of 21%, it means that whichever country is headquartered in United States, they have to pay 21% of their profits to the United States. So let's assume that Google, which is a private company, is headquartered in United States, and let's assume that its profit is 100 rupees. As its profit is 100 rupees and United States has a corporate tax of 21%, it would have to pay 210 rupees. So it will have to pay 210 rupees. And let's assume that there is a country where there is corporate tax rate of only 1%. We have countries such as the Cyprus. We have the countries such as the Virgin Islands, where the corporate tax rates are less than 5%. So if Google somehow changes its headquarters from United States to Cyprus, it would only have to pay 10 rupees even if its profit is 1000 rupees, because earlier it have to pay 21%. So it paid 210 rupees. Now if the tax on the corporates in Cyprus is 1%, it will have to pay only 10 rupees if it's earning 1000 rupees. So what many companies are doing is that they are shifting their headquarters from high taxation countries to low taxation countries. So Google might shift from United States to Cyprus, Virgin Islands, or to Hong Kong, where the corporate tax rates are very less compared to the United States. So to prevent these corporates from misusing the difference in the corporate tax rates across the countries, Mr. Biden, who is the president of the United States, has asked other member countries to adopt 21% as minimum tax rate. So if you take an example, let's assume that there is a country here and it is charging only 12.5%, and let's assume that he might cancel the Copa America games. So what is this Copa American games? Copa America is a men's football tournament. It is a men's football championship or a tournament, and this championship is held every year in the South American continent, and this football championship matches is scheduled to take place in Rio de Janeiro, which is a city in Brazil. And the mayor of the city is stating that due to increasing number of COVID cases, if we schedule the matches here and if we allow people, more number of COVID-19 infections can arise. So I might cancel these games that are scheduled to take place in my city. Next, we have an article which is talking about the Julius Baer Challengers Chess Tour. So whenever you hear the word Julius Baer Championship or the Julius Baer Challenge, you should know that this is relating to the event of chess. And it is stated that Mr. Pragnananda, who is a Indian child grandmaster, has stated that he will be taking part in this chess championship. Next, we have an article where it is stated Indian team has lost in the Asian Football Championship. So Indian team has lost in the Asian Football Championship, which is being held in the Doha, which is the capital of Oman. Next, we have an article where Tech Mahindra has signed a MOU with FIDE. So what is this FIDE? FIDE stands for International Chess Federation. So International Chess Federation and the Tech Mahindra have signed an MOU to bring in a chess league which is being called as the Global Chess League. So this will be a new chess championship that will be conducted by Tech Mahindra and FIDE. And with this, we have come to the end of this session. Inform about Ador's initiative to your other aspirant friends. Thank you for watching. Ador Solutions. Add-on desires.